was automation, because it assured accuracy. An automated count being more accurate than a manual count, and was faster, which would unburden the people, especially the teachers, of the drudgery of a manual system. The chosen technology even then was OMR. In both the manual and the automated elections, the precinct count is the best evidence of the vote, other than the ballot itself. But the main difference is that the manual process requires that the national canvassing and proclamation be based on provincial and city certificates of canvass. That opened the door to wholesale cheating. Automation, on the other hand, allows the election return to be transmitted directly, with the ladderized certificates of canvass being nominally used to comply with legal technicalities, thereby bypassing the canvassing cheaters, assuming, of course, there is no internal rigging. The estimated cost of automation in 1992 was about $1 billion over 5 years. It was supposed to start in 1998. By 2010, the cost had ballooned to $13.3 billion. And accounts for 68% of the total cost of $16.5 billion. This cost might increase with the increase in voters and with the possible reduction in the number of precincts clustered to reduce congestion. And with more IT-savvy cheaters to deal with, the risks and thus the cost of the battle would escalate even more. From what I see about elections in 1992, I am no longer sure that the biggest problem in elections is wholesale fraud. For one, wholesale fraud is not a nationwide phenomenon, at least not in the scale and brazenness with which it's done at the ARM, which accounts for only about 5% of the voting population. But at ARM, more than wholesale fraud, the problem is warlordism, with the complicity of government officials, the military, and the PNP. In warlord-dominated areas, they don't change the results. They simply dictate them, which can happen even with automation. Over the years, the use of money in elections, most of it ultimately sourced from government, has become more of a problem and exacerbates the problems of vote buying, warlordism, and the corruption of election officials. This may be a good time for us to re-examine our agenda on electoral reform. Even if the automation in 2010 is cleared after proper independent reviews as trustworthy despite its shortcomings, we should ask the following questions. As raised by the German Federal Constitutional Court, does the use of a computer count and determination of the result that cannot be examined by an ordinary citizen reliably and without specialist knowledge violate the principle of the public nature of elections? The court said it does violate. Essentially, it is an interesting issue. Essentially, the issue of a private vote and a public count. But granting that we determine that it is not violative of the Constitution, we should ask the question, is automation cost-effective and still worth the expense if we can successfully address the problem, such other problems as warlordism, the use of government money for partisan purposes, the governance problems, and the many procedural details that can make or unmake elections? Will solving the other problems make wholesale fraud less of a problem, which we can address with less expensive and less risky systems that would assure accuracy while giving the voters the ease of voting and faster results that they obviously prefer? What will that system look like? I don't have the answers to those questions today. I just want to ask our experts in the IT community and our election practitioners to please think about it and maybe make better sense of it than I can, because I do not think the COMELEC or the Congress are doing that kind of thinking. So I am challenging our friends in civil society, who care about the future of our democratic elections and of our country to work together as we have done before, or have we forgotten? To find the answers to the questions and once again be the vanguards for change. In the timeless words of the assassinated Archbishop Oscar Romero of El Salvador, quote, "It helps now and then to step back and take a longer view. We plant seeds that one day will grow. We lay foundations that will need further development. We are workers, not master builders. We are ministers, not messiahs. We are prophets of a future, not our own." Thank you and good day.